Dev, the teacher should become a good mentor and ask the students to choose their own area, choose their own problems. This is exactly what I also do with my own students. I don't expect everybody to become a researcher. In fact, very few I expect will become researchers. But the ones who show interest, I ask them to actually find their own problems.
As industrialized countries face increased competition from countries with lower labor costs, growth in greatest is specialized high-tech sectors, which a number of underlying forces are shaping. The 21st century is trumpeted as an era where societies increasingly will be shaped by advances in science and technology. Research and development investment plays a crucial role in underwriting enhancement of this capacity across industrialized countries and account for much of the variation in their economic performance. Hello and welcome to the Honest Talk by Freak Folks. I'm Harsh Pandey. For this particular session, we have with us very special guest today, Professor Nitin Saxena, sir. He's an Indian scientist in mathematics and theoretical computer science. His research focuses on computational complexities. He completed his bachelor's in computer science from the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur in the year 2002. And completed his PhD under Mahindra Agarwal in 2006. He is broadly interested in computational complexity theory, algebra, geometry, and number theory. He has been a visiting graduate student in Princeton University 2003 to 2004 and National University of Singapore, a postdoc at CWI Amsterdam, and a Boon Junior Fellow at Hausdorff Center for Mathematics, Bonn. Since April 2013, he have a faculty position in the Department of Computer Science Engineering at IIT Kanpur. So first of all, sir, I welcome you to in this session. Thank you so much for joining and agreeing to share your thoughts with us.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So
thank you, Harsh.
So moving to the topic of today's session, which we have chosen is youth involvement in research. From a purely educational standpoint, there is no better way to learn science than by doing science, which is why even a huge introductory courses often have a laboratory component. Time and resource constraint often limit what can be explored in lab classes, through while more open-ended research projects give students a much deeper experience and develop hands-on lab skills in a way that's difficult to do in a fixed class period. But in the past recent year, we have seen the trend that today's youth are choosing well-paid job in the corporate then going into the research and development sites. They are not finding it as much interesting and fascinating. Sir, in your opinion, what are the factors behind this? May I request you to please explain to this our viewers?
Yeah, so we cannot blame the students if they are not choosing research and development, because there is a time in their life when they are learning these things for the first time. So you cannot expect the students to learn it for the first time and immediately get excited about research in an area.
Yes.
I mean, because the way these things have developed, they have developed over 5 years, 10 years, or maybe after hundreds of years, right? So automatically, I mean, it is obvious that these things actually take time. Research takes time, and it takes many people, many man hours, many women hours, and so on. So it cannot be hurried. And also they are being taught too many things, many subjects. So the focus is more on, I guess, the width, the breadth, than the depth. So I think the first part you cannot really avoid. You have to give breadth. You have to expose them more and more to new things. But then once they have been exposed to some extent, then I think the teacher should become a good mentor and ask the students to choose their own area, choose their own problems. This is exactly what I also do with my own students. I don't expect everybody to become a researcher. In fact, very few I expect will become researchers, but the ones who show interest, I ask them to actually find their own problems. And I can potentially work with my students on any problem, any area that has some overlap with my interest. And I think this is this I find is the best way, or it may be the only way actually, to encourage people who are interested to work more in their research problem. And the important thing to remember is that not everyone will become a researcher. It's just like not everyone will become a musician.
Correct.
So, I mean, very few people will become musician, and very few people, even fewer, will become famous musicians.
Yes.
So that has to be always remembered. But still, most of the people can appreciate music, right? Mm. So a mentor, a teacher's job is that most of the students should be able to appreciate research and should be able to appreciate science and scientific thought. At the same time, remember that they will not become scientists.
Indeed, sir. So, I think actually you have described this. So my next question to you is actually what we have seen is that more than 3/4 of a school in the country do not have the fully equipped science laboratories for students in class 11 and 12. And a survey of 2.4 lakh secondary and senior secondary schools have found for class 9 and 10, where an integrated science module is taught to students, over 58% don't have the requisite lab. How do you see this? Is this main reason behind lesser participation of today's youth in research? Because as you have very rightly said that we cannot expect everyone to go into the research side. But what is needed in this fast-paced changing world is that research mindset. This is crucial, I think, for everyone. So what are your views on this, sir?
See, so what you are talking about is mainly the infrastructural problems that people in India face. And then especially students face it. I think the solutions are well known. The problem is how to implement, or how well can the government implement it. But across the world, it has always happened that if people demand, which is at the lowest level, the local people demand, the community demands, or in fact, to demand, first you have to make a list of your demands. You have to understand what is important, what is at a higher priority, what is at a lower priority. You have to prioritize your demands, put them in the right form, put them to the right people. So I think if the community produces such leaders who are interested in solving these problems, or at least presenting these problems to the local government, that has already improved the infrastructure at the local level, and it will improve more and more as more and more awareness is there. Now, there has been in the last 10, 15, 20 years a telecommunication revolution. So even if children, students, or people don't have schools in the village, they will still have a phone. And nowadays, maybe they even will have internet connection. So I think that awareness is really going all the way down to the roots. And now they just have to structure themselves so that they can also identify the problems, form a demand from the local government, and be constructive about it. I mean, these infrastructure problems are huge, so I cannot really give a solution here.
Indeed,
it's more about implementation. Yeah, it's more about people participation, as the Prime Minister himself says.
Yes.
I mean, exactly. People have to participate in a mission mode. Yeah.
Correct. And sir, what my next question is that we have seen this research experience can transform a student's conception of what science is and their whole career trajectory. And research projects are fundamentally different than classwork, and the experience of doing research can engage students in wholly different ways. Sir, in your opinion, what can be the ways to foster research environment and engage more youth in it in the higher education institution of our country?
So the question is about higher educational institutes.
Yes, higher education.
Or primary secondary level.
Primary secondary levels. I think we have already discussed, because there is some kind of infrastructure.
Okay. So you are talking about higher educational. Yes. Yeah, so in higher educational institutes, the the teachers who are hired, they have a much higher threshold to cross. So anyways, they have done their masters. I mean, they have definitely done their bachelor's, but usually they have also done their master's, PhD. And if you want to get hired in IITs and other premier institutes, central government institutes, you have to be far ahead of PhD. You must have done postdoc and you must have published and so on. So with that kind of teachers and mentors and researchers, instructors in the courses, of course, they know their area well. They have seen research papers, they have written them. So my advice to them will just be that they should, since the classes are very large, when you teach a course, the classes these days are like multiples of 100 students.
Correct.
So this ties with my first question, that you cannot expect to attract all the students in your class to your area. But once you encourage them to find a problem or read a paper and present it, volunteer to present it. You should not force them to do research or survey or present, but you can make it a voluntary assignment or task in your course. And you will see that minimum 10%, maybe 30% of the students will show interest. They will come with their own topics. They will survey something. They will give presentations. And I think these are the 20-30% of your class, or maybe 10% of your class, whom you should help. And if you can help them, if you can further motivate them, they will definitely move towards R&D. So I think you should focus on, form these smaller groups and focus on them.
Okay.
As far as R&D is concerned.
Yes. Actually, I think you have made a great point that we need to actually focus on more actually quality rather than just quantity. And sir, my next question is, and I want to present to one data with my viewers, is that to increase economic growth and productivity, countries often invest in research and development. This is often an indicative of the country's dedication to science and technology. The broader literature suggests that research and development expenditure positively impact total factor productivity by increasing output per worker. I want to share data with my viewers is that India's gross expenditure on R&D is 0.65% of GDP, significantly lower than top 10 economies spent 1.5 to 3%. Though India was ranked 48 among 131 innovating countries in the Global Innovation Index 2020, a huge leap from the 81st position in 2015. The survey noted that the government does the heavy lifting to R&D, and there's a need for the business to contribute more to the sector. India has shown improvement in the metrics like innovation inputs, creative outputs, knowledge and technology outputs, headcount, infrastructure, market sophistication, business sophistication, and others, but lacks in patent application filed by resident Indians compared with non-resident. Sir, my question to you is actually, how do you see this? Because we have seen that India lacks in patent application filed by the resident Indians.
See, patent applications, I think the companies and also people who do applied stuff in universities, in institutes, they are filing patents. Why the number is small compared to other countries and the statistics which you present, I think these statistics are, it's a dynamic number which keeps changing every year. I think 20 years ago, it must have been worse.
Correct.
And 10 years ago, it improved, and now it has improved further. So these are dynamic approximations to what is happening in the country, within the country, and also in comparison to other countries. I don't think we should worry too much about this, because this is not where we can reach, where we can be. I mean, this is what we are currently now, but
yes.
I think in the future, it can be far better. And in fact, how much better, that is also kind of unimaginable. So the more important thing is, what is the trend? So is the government, are the people aware? Is the government taking steps so that there are incremental improvements? More people get opportunities to file, well, first of all, do R&D. More people get opportunities. Are they getting more opportunities to do R&D, to start companies, to commercialize it? Are there more opportunities If somebody has an idea, already implemented an idea, they want to commercialize and patent it, are there opportunities to get funding? And because patent is also an expensive thing. So automatically countries which are richer will have more patents because they can spend more money and more time on the patent. Forget about the research. Research is done. But mm-hmm. even after that, getting the patent filed is a legal process. That needs a lot of money and a lot of time, resources. So richer countries will do it more. So I don't think we should worry too much about that. It's about whether the trend of these opportunities, whether it is improving or not. As far as the potential is concerned, I think the potential is unlimited.
Mm.
Yeah, so look at the trend and...
No, actually,
I don't have very specific comments about this because I think the trend is only improving.
Yes.
And I don't see how we can improve it much, much faster, except maybe creating more universities, more opportunities for the people of India.
Indeed, sir. No, actually, you have, this was really a very impressive answer because you have mentioned that this is something because we have seen in the past year. The trends is positive and now the government and the organization are more supportive towards it and they actually understood the importance of this R&D. So my next question to you is, we have seen consequently several MNCs have shifted or are shifting their research and development base to India. These R&D base either develop product to serve the local market or help the parent companies overseas to deliver new innovative generation of product faster to the market across the world. Sir, what do you think is this type of research environment is going to help India? Actually, it is going to help India to boost its economy.
No, sure. I mean, no doubt. There should be no doubt that government should attract MNCs to set up base in India. Not just low-level jobs, but actually highly skilled jobs. They should shift to India. Startups... Obviously, government will focus on startups and will fund startups and will encourage people who want to start startups who have an idea. But MNCs, which are already established, which are quite wealthy, they have more liquidity. They should be attracted even more, actually, to the... I mean, they should be given facilities, they should be given land or whatever is needed, approvals. They should be encouraged to move to India because, as I said in the first question, that not everyone will do research, not mm-hmm. everyone will start startups. There will still be, let's say, a large percentage of your students and your trained personnel who would want to just join an MNC, just take up a job which has lesser risk.
Correct.
than R&D or startup. So they also should be able to contribute to the economy. They should be able to sell products, buy products, and so on, right? They should also be allowed to have a life. So you need to create all kinds of opportunities for jobs. No doubt about that.
Indeed, sir. I think this was really a very great answer. And sir, one more question, because I can say, sir, there's a lot more to learn from you, but today actually we are having a limited kind of a time. So I don't want to take too much of your time. So moving to my last question of this session, actually, this is not very much related to the topic, but because you deal with these trends in your everyday life. So I want to seek some advices for our current youth generation. Because we know that youth is a time of enormous energies and a lot of youth are in confused state of mind. The youth of today's generation need clarity and balance. They have become the victim of social media information overload. Everywhere there's a compulsion. They are addicted to smoking, alcohol, drugs, and gruesome video materials. Actually, there's a substance abuse like never before. So what are these small efforts we can practice to bring an awareness among the youth just to remind them of their enormous energies, how to balance them and lead their life well?
Yeah, so I think the problems which you mentioned, especially the problems you mentioned in the end about internet addictions, addiction to substances and so on. This has always happened in countries when the countries went through the industrialization process, they became more materialistic and the families became wealthier.
Yes.
So it wasn't the case that when the families became wealthier, the children became more intelligent. or they became more careful. In fact, usually what happened is that they cannot appreciate how the wealth was created.
Yes.
And they got more opportunities to actually squander the wealth. So how do they squander it? Well, they will buy whatever they can get.
Correct.
And they will buy those things more, which can give them faster happiness. So social media is a way to get faster happiness, or at least an outlet which is much faster. Whatever pictures you have, whatever things you have to say, you can immediately put it out. I mean, there is no peer review. There is no advice to you being given. You don't have second thoughts. You immediately do it. So it fits well with your impulsive nature, which is more as you are younger.
Yes.
So, and the same thing, I guess, with substance abuse. I started with the point that all these things other countries have also seen, the countries as they develop these problems happen. If you want to put it in two words, I think it is that, we start with a culture, we start with a community. And then as we focus more and more on technology, as we focus more and more on commercialization or consumption of materialistic goods, somehow we tend to forget our culture and our community.
Right.
And our society. So that focus goes away. It moves completely to the consumption side. So you earn more and you consume more. And the focus is less on how can you contribute more. So I think the principle here is that, okay, you will earn more and you will consume more, but then you also have to somehow remember the third parameter, which is that you should have a contribution. You should contribute to society. You should contribute to culture. So I feel that somehow some of these European countries are better in that. They went through cycles, but ultimately there is this idea that they will contribute to art, they will contribute to the society, they will contribute to social organizations, they will contribute to music, and so on. So, I mean, there are hundreds of areas you can contribute to, not just consume them, but also contribute to them so that other people who don't have opportunities can create something new there. So that is, I think, one example that they can pick. How to do that, how to implement it, how to encourage the students or these people who have who are not able to think all these things on their own. I guess you give them means to read. I mean, if they read more, not just social media, but they read books, they delve more into art. They maybe travel more, meet more people. I guess that it can open up their minds. It can kind of divert them from this abuse, that consumption of abuse cycle. Maybe they can come out of that. I think these are the parameters which probably you can focus on in the implementation.
Indeed, sir. I think you have stressed on the actually concrete problems, all this behind us. And this was really, sir, insightful session with you. Thank you so much for joining and giving your important time. We look forward to conduct more such session with you in future. And thank you so much, sir, for joining. Thank you again.
Okay. Thank you very much. On the ground is where I stand. Never give up. That was always the plan. It's so cold outside. I'm alone. I'm all right. It's so cold. I'm alone.